All right, well, it is 3:02 Eastern time here in New York, so we might as well get started. I know some folks might be joining us, you know, a little after the hour, but hello and welcome and thank you for being here. This is the first of our CCC OER webinars for spring 2023. It's entitled Designing Professional Development Opportunities to Increase Faculty Engagement with OER. My name is Ryan McKinney. I am a professor of theater and the director of the Kingsborough Center for Teaching and Learning at Kingsborough Community College in Brooklyn, New York. And I also serve as one of the members of the Professional Development Committee within CCC OER that puts together these webinars each semester. So I wanna thank you all for joining us today, as well as our presenters and the entire Professional Development Committee, including our Vice President of Professional Development, Shinta Hernandez. I'm really excited for this webinar, for the presentations that we have, and to talk about the various strategies that we use at our individual campuses to promote OER and to create faculty and professional development opportunities around the topic of open education and open pedagogy. Before we jump in, I just want to frame our webinar and give you a little bit of background very quickly on the Community College Consortium on Open Educational Resources. So our agenda for today, as I just said, I'll give us a quick overview. And then David Tully is going to do a presentation on some of the OER faculty development work done at North Carolina State University Libraries. And that will be followed by two of our colleagues at Penn State Lehigh Valley, Larry Mussolino and Elizabeth Nelson. We'll be talking about fostering a culture of OER at their campus. And then at the end, we'll have time for a Q&A, followed by a little bit of advertising for upcoming events and how you can stay in the loop with CCC OER events. So the mission of CCC OER is to expand awareness and access to high quality OER, to support faculty choice and development, to foster regional OER leadership, and to improve student equity and success. And if you go to the CCC OER website, you can see the various ways that the organization does that. This webinar is one of the ways, as well as various programming throughout the year, including the Arlo program, and other conferences and professional development opportunities. I first got involved with CCC OER 2 years ago when I started at Kingsborough as the Open Education Coordinator, and it's been a really great support organization for me and my work. Oh, we're going way too fast, sorry. Okay. So our membership as of 2023, you can see we have 107 members across 37 states and into Canada. And if you are interested in learning more about becoming a member, if you're an individual member, or if your institution becoming a member, you can visit that link right there. These slides and the presentation will be available after today's webinar. So once again, my eternal thanks to our speakers who, when I reached out to them, said yes and are here to share their knowledge and their experience with us. Our first presenter, as I said, will be David Tully, who's the Librarian for Student Success and Affordability at North Carolina State University Libraries. And then following that, we'll have a two-person panel presentation presented by Larry Mussolino, Assistant Teaching Professor of Mathematics at Penn State University Lehigh Valley Campus, and Elizabeth Nelson, who is the Reference and Instruction Librarian, also at Penn State University Lehigh Valley Campus. So without further ado, I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and David, I'm going to send it over to you. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you, Ryan. Let's see if I can get this screen shared. Here we go. Okay, hopefully now you see a drone circling our beloved bell tower here on our beautiful campus in Raleigh, North Carolina. So my name is David Tully. I am the librarian for student success and affordability at the libraries at NC State. I've worked for libraries for about 10 years now, and I've been working sort of very closely in open education programs for the last sort of like 4 years or so, and in my current position for over a year, just over a year, I think it is. So I want to talk to you regarding something that's really important to us, which is this idea of building communities of practice around OER development and some of the things that we've done here to support that. So before we get into some of those sort of community-minded programs which we've developed, I wanted to share a bit of background information about NT State, because our programs grow out of work that we've been doing for really quite a while now, and also because they have a pretty strong local flavor to them that you might choose to localize in your own way. So NC State, as a lot of you will no doubt know, is a very large STEM-focused sort of research one university, and you can see some of our numbers here around enrollment and the types of students, as well as some of the probably the areas of focus of our institution. Now, we do have this motto. The character of our institution is very much embodied by this idea of think and do. So the university and the libraries are really committed to this idea of practice-based work that puts our sort of our public mission, I guess, sort of front and center. And you can see those values in the types of open education work that we've been doing for the past decade or so. So from the very beginning, I think it's fair to say that we've been very sort of teams based. So we really value different and multiple perspectives, different types of expertise that sort of come together to do some of the great things that we think, well, hopefully we think that we've done. But we're also extremely pragmatic, and often we choose to focus on particular problems that needs to be solved. And the way that we do that and communicate about that is often done by storytelling, I suppose, that really puts sort of people first rather than resources or collections. So the arc of that work starts with some sort of foundational work that originally took place in sort of 2010, 2011. And then in 2013 expanded with a series of sort of mini grants that we offered through our alt textbook program. So we've just turned 10 years on that program itself. And it's just really expanded from there in lots of new and really exciting ways. It's fair to say, I think, that the through line for that work stayed very much the same. And that's this phrase right here, do something a textbook can't do. And it's this idea that we keep on sort of coming back to. So this idea of supporting faculty in doing something that they can't find through their all rights reserved textbook is really our type of North Star. I also want to say that I think, unlike other types of OER programs, which start off with a really strong emphasis on a cost-saving mission or an aim to publish a lot of new textbooks, we've always from the beginning sort of emphasized sort of hands-on transformative work that leverages our strengths as a university and the libraries. So things like technology, copyright, instructional design. And we joke among ourselves that, in a sense, we've been doing open pedagogy before we even sort of really knew to use that term. In addition to the alt textbook program, we've also drawn upon another library program called the Open Incubator program, which focused on bringing sort of open interventions to the research enterprise by building small cohorts of faculty. So I'm about to come on to our, not to confuse you, Open Pedagogy Incubator. There's a lot of very similar titles in play here, which was really our attempt to kind of bring some of these programs together in a new and interesting way. The through line that I talked about just now, by doing something a textbook can't, is built upon a recognition that so we see cost as certainly a key part of the puzzle, and we recognize that the cost of materials is just tremendously important as a question of equity, organizational mission, to name, I think, just a few things. but we also strongly believe that it's not the only part of the puzzle, and that sort of cost probably is not more important than questions of agency, equity, and authenticity. And I think it's fair to say we think that in particular, and feel it, I guess, with a sense of urgency, because we recognize that this one size fits all model does not apply these days. And it ultimately does a disservice to a diverse student body, which is what we have here. So on the screen, I'm showing you some statistics from North Carolina, but these are trends that we see reflected, if not nationally, also globally as well. So any textbook that's written for, let's say, a white male, upper class, 18-year-old living on campus with an eye on entering the professions on graduation is a bad fit for most of our students. So we want to do something that's better for them. And that something better over the last 3 to 4 years has really sort of coalesced around this idea of open pedagogy. So we're inspired by practices that represent students' lived experiences, that value their expertise, and really overall focus on creating sort of authentic learning and relationships between instructors and student. And this goes back to what I've been, I guess, saying from the beginning of this, hands-on work, public service oriented, is really sort of where we're at and goes to the heart of open pedagogy. Parallel to that, we've also explored ways to create a community of instructors on campus. And again, I mentioned one size doesn't fit all in aspect of students. That's also true of instructors as well. So we could, and we have ran topic specific sort of programs on open enabled practices. And we have also provided sort of grants for instructors to do that type of work. But of course, open pedagogy is about, at the heart of it, what we believe to be this sense of sort of community and process, as much as it's about a particular product that gets produced and goes back to the commons. So we were really interested to find a way to, not to, I guess, teach skills, but to build a sort of a full community of practice. And in 2020, that culminated in the implementation of our first open pedagogy incubator program. So right away, you can, I guess, see from the language here that it's a semester-long program, and it's specifically designed to incentivize and support faculty in sort of moving beyond the first step of adopting openly licensed materials by implementing open enabled sort of practices into their own courses. So you can sort of imagine it as a faculty member who's interested in the incubator applies, and if they're accepted, they're trained up and they gain knowledge, skills, and support in the three areas that you'll see here with bullet points. So first off, the potential of open pedagogy. Second, current and emerging models of open pedagogical practice, including renewable assignments. And then ultimately, they'll leave with a set of concrete sort of processes for implementing open pedagogy in the specific course that they'll be leading. So a faculty member applies and they say, next semester I'm teaching such and such course, I want to do some open interventions there. Then they join the incubator program, and then ultimately at the culmination of that, they're prepared to go and sort of do that work in the course in question. So the way it works is, it's kind of, the program itself is built around these, there's three specific aspects to it. The first is this set of sort of cohort meetings where we bring together our cohort instructors and begin to have a conversation about who they are, what they teach, how they teach the way that they teach, and what they find about open pedagogy that's sort of particularly inspiring or exciting to them. So sort of starting to build that community at the outset through these shared conversations, and through readings that our cohort digitally annotate as well and comment upon beforehand using a tool like we've used Hypothesis. We've also used VoiceThread as well. That's the first step of the program. The second aspect is a series of workshops. So in addition to those cohort meetings, we also run parallel a track of workshops in different topics related to open pedagogy. We normally have workshops that are based around theory and workshops that are based around specific sort of tools. I just mentioned some, there's others such as sort of WikiEDU to throw you a sort of a popular example as well, but also several others that I sort of may come onto. And we ask our faculty to help identify the topics for those workshops. So what are they interested in? What do they want to learn? What's most valuable to them? And then we design the program, or you know, what workshops get covered according to their sort of their interest levels. We also don't limit our workshops to our cohort. So we don't, you know, require our faculty to be in the incubator to attend a workshop. So if something is of interest to a faculty member, any faculty member can come along. If you're in the program, we ask you to attend at least 4 workshops, but they're not closed, as it were, to the rest of campus. And we've also seen it in the past where a faculty member has attended a workshop, heard about this incubator thing that keeps on getting talked about, sparked an interest, and then they themselves have applied to be in a cohort in the following iteration about it. So individual cohort meetings for the small group, workshops available to everybody, and obviously required for participation in the program. The third aspect is ultimately sort of the culmination, really, finishing the incubator with a concrete specific set of open interventions for the particular courses in question. So by the end of the program, a faculty member can say, I've learned these things, I've done these things, hopefully I can't wait to do this and that and the other thing. And these are going to be my set of open interventions. Now, in terms of our structure, it's a semester-long experience. We intentionally built it to be a flexible, blended structure. So these practices sort of come together in this sort of coordinated semester-long experience that often looks something like this, really. That initial foundational cohort meeting where folks come together, done the reading, but have a conversation, get to know each other, and help us think about what a good menu of workshops actually would look like. And then they'll disperse and they'll select the workshops that are sort of most meaningful to them, that they're interested in exploring. And they might see each other in some of those workshops, but they also might not. As I mentioned before, we ask that they attend at least 4. What we find with most of our cohort is that folks want to attend everything, which is great. But also at the same point, we don't make it a requirement. But if they want to attend everything, then we're certainly not going to prevent them from doing that. At the post-workshops, there's like the midway sort of points, which is more discussion-based. So what have I covered so far? What am I excited by or inspired by? What have I taken that, you know, isn't quite for me? And this is why I think like sort of what it is. We then move along to a set of what we call kind of like participant selected tools. So these are technically workshops, but they have a different type of format. They're similar-ish to sort of TED Talks in that they are, you know, pretty short and sweet. And then we tack on discussion heavy sessions immediately following them. We have a menu normally of around like a dozen items, and we ask our cohort to select like 6 according to sort of rank of sort of preference and so on. And then we implement them. And at this point, we start to bring in other guests. So we've had instructors from elsewhere on campus. And in some cohorts, we've brought in instructors who've been through previous cohorts who have already enabled their open interventions to speak firsthand about their open pedagogy and how things are going, some challenges that they've encountered along the way, and so on. Then we have our final meeting, which is our application. So again, what folks are going to be moving on to do post-program. And then we collect our feedback, which helps obviously to inform the next iteration of this program itself. So I guess we should talk about the who of the incubator. You can see that we're very deliberate about identifying people from different stages of their career, different disciplines, different levels of experience, different departments and fields, basically overall. So our idea going into this was we didn't want to create a program where, to take an example, you know, a bunch of chemists are talking to each other about open pedagogy. That would be cool and everything else. But what we found to be much more interesting was this idea of being sort of interdisciplinary. So a chemist can attend our incubator to harp on to continue that track of that example, but they can have a conversation with an historian or a psychologist or an English professor or a professor from parks, recreation and tourism management or something like that. That really for us is the community aspect of this. This chance to sort of cross-pollinate between the disciplines and have conversations about how these aspects, these topics that we cover in the program can be applied in all sorts of different ways and according to the discipline. These are our first two cohorts that I'm showing you here. These aren't the only folks that have been through our program, but these were the first two cohorts. So in addition to our incubators, more recently, we've also joined forces with some of the other schools in the University of North Carolina system to develop a pilot program that is focused upon developing a localized, inclusive OER around specific disciplines, in this particular case, mathematics. So one of the challenges that people, I think, often report back about implementing open pedagogy is how to do it at scale, right? That's a real problem. So we think that one of the solutions to an issue like that, or many of the other issues that people face, I think, when developing, when working, you know, in OP in general, is the solutions are often found, and the answers are often found through the community itself, going right back, you know, 10, 12 years to how I think we sort of began this journey with an eye on community practice. So in this specific example, with the aid of a generous grant by the Lyricist Foundation, we created an 8-week pilot program last fall, and it was facilitated by librarians and instructional faculty from the various schools, so across the system level, to support folks from the math departments in redesigning their courses around a series of open interventions. And I think this is something that we'll hopefully start to see more of, to run parallel to our sort of regular incubator. We may start to do these more subject specific ones to do specific things like developing OER that's specific to that subject. But in terms of our next steps, that actually is already sort of underway and begins in a few weeks' time, which is the first iteration of the University of North Carolina system incubator. So NC State has partnered with several of the other schools in the system to create our first incubator that's based off of the model that NC State developed. So we're sort of following closely, I think it's fair to say, to that model, but obviously we're able to sort of partner with our other folks, develop this community at a system level, which is really important to us, invite along people, faculty from other schools who haven't been doing sort of work like this and otherwise may not have been easily accessible to them. Through partnering with the other schools and sort of scaling up, as it were, we're able to expand our reach, expand our cohort size, and influence more, touch upon more instructors, and hopefully then, by that, you know, following that track, support more students ultimately, which is our aim. And again, I mentioned just now that we've completed 10 years of the Arts Textbook Program. So we've been doing a lot of work looking at that impact. We've worked with over 100 projects in that time. We've had been able to calculate some pretty large numbers of cost savings, which again is one of the sort of key, not the only, but one of the key things which is important to us. And we've just had, in terms of applications, our largest number to date in the fall semester. So that program goes from strength to strength. We've also recently been able to subscribe or purchase a license to Pressbooks, because a lot of our faculty, including from the incubator, want to move into the publishing realm. So we're partnering with Pressbooks to provide that software and that tool. A lot of our folks at the incubator have been inspired to create textbooks with their students, including a couple of the names that I'm looking at here. So again, we especially like, you know, folks from one program moving in very smoothly to another one, enabling them to do the thing that they got inspired by in the previous program, such as the incubator. We've made all of our materials freely accessible, as one might expect. So the link on the screen will take you to the OSF page, where you can find our slideshows, our handouts, our curriculum, all of our materials. So please take a screenshot of that. Or if not, I will make sure that I put that in the chat for you to take a look at. And I want to say thank you for listening to me, and really looking forward to your questions, your thoughts and your ideas. My contact is on the screen here if you want to follow up with me at a later point as well. Thank you.
David, thank you so much. That was really great. There's many questions in the chat that we're going to come back to once we get through the second presentation. But we offer like similar programming here at Kingsborough, and you've already given me like 10 ideas on how I can improve that programming. So thank you so much. Next up, we have Larry Mussolino and Elizabeth Nelson from Penn State Lehigh Valley. Larry and Elizabeth, tossing it over to you. Thanks so much.
Perfect. Thank you. Can everybody see the slides okay? All right. Awesome. So thanks, everybody. We're here to talk about fostering a culture of OER at Penn State Lehigh Valley. And just as kind of a reminder, I'm Elizabeth Nelson. I'm the reference and instruction librarian for our campus. And Larry, do you want to reintroduce yourself real quick?
Yeah, I'm Larry Mussolino. I'm assistant teaching professor, and I teach mathematics and statistics courses at Penn State Lehigh Valley.
Perfect. Thank you. So we just wanted to give you a little bit of context about our campus before we get started. Penn State Lehigh Valley is, obviously we're part of the Penn State University, but we are a relatively small, fully commuter campus within the Penn State system. We enroll about 900 students annually. To give you an idea of our size. We offer 10 degrees that can be fully completed at our campus, but our students can also start here and then finish the final 2 years of any PSU degree at other campuses around the Commonwealth. And right now we have currently 97 faculty members, 42 full-time and 55 part-time. And while we don't have our own campus center for teaching and learning or anything like that, our faculty are supported by a variety of other units around the campus, as you can see listed on the slide. So in a way, in our own context, we're kind of striving to build our own sort of biodiversity for our campus environment, like the rainforest you see in our slides, but instead we're supporting diverse open educational projects rather than diverse plant and animal life. The open educational work that's happening around our campus includes everything from OER adoptions and adaptations to open pedagogy projects, as well as lots of open educational outreach to and among our faculty. Each of these projects have unique needs in terms of what kinds of support they need, what kinds of goals they're trying to achieve, and how they're planning to grow, assess, and expand. And while our projects do sometimes need to compete for resources, especially funding, by collaborating, we're finding that we can work strategically together to map out a growth plan that allows all of our projects to advance and get the resources they need together or in sequence as needed. We can identify which of our projects need immediate support, which might need more time for planning before they get started, and which are now ready to share back what they're doing to the community. And by sharing back what we're learning and achieving on the way, we're kind of helping to improve the soil for open education projects at our campus in general and encourage new projects to take root and grow, not to push this metaphor too far. We're going to focus on this last idea today, though, by sharing with you two strategies that we're using to foster our OER culture and several examples of each strategy in action. So our first strategy is peer learning to build expertise around open education, and I'm going to hand it off to Larry to share more about that.
Yeah, thanks, Elizabeth. So, David mentioned community of practices, and that's really the first example of peer learning that I wanted to share also. And the definition we typically use is a group of people who share a concern or passion for something they do and learn how to do it better as they interact on a regular basis. So we've added a discipline-specific lens to this and a focus on OER. And this has kind of ended up being a group of faculty and librarians and instructional designers and support staff and students who focus on OER and practices. And of course, the goal is to improve the teaching and learning content and learning outcomes. And so at Penn State Lehigh Valley, we formed a community of practice for the math discipline. And this has resulted in several successful OER projects for our math courses. We've been able to share this across the Penn State system. One project we recently completed was an open source calculus workbook that was actually funded through a grant that we obtained from the state of Pennsylvania. And for this project, several members of this math community of practice got together. Elizabeth from the library staff was a key participant. And we put together a workbook with a key calculus concept, worked out examples and exercises for students as in-class activities. And we're currently using this workbook in several calculus courses. It's had good success. Students have responded very positively to this open source workbook. By the way, we're happy to share this with anyone who's interested. This is soon going to be available on a public website. The state of Pennsylvania was putting together an open repository to collect together some of these open resources that were funded through grants. It's not available yet, but hopefully this repository is going to be available soon. Again, we're happy to share any of our content with anyone interested. And there's some links down here in the lower left-hand corner of the slide if anyone's interested in some more details about our community of practices that we've initiated at Penn State. I'll pass it back to Elizabeth for the next slide.
Perfect, thank you. So in addition to our communities of practice on campus, we're also participating in a larger program from our university libraries called OER Leads. The OER Leads program was begun in 2022 by three librarians at three different Penn State campuses, Christina Riemann Murphy at Penn State Abington, Brian McGeary at Penn State Greater Allegheny, and myself at Penn State Lehigh Valley. The goal of OER Leads is to grow a distributed network of open expertise across the Penn State campuses by using a train-the-trainer model to get participating librarians ready to support OER adoptions at their campuses. And I feel like I should point out too that librarians at Penn State are both, there are some staff librarians, but there's also a lot of faculty librarians. So in a way, this is also faculty development among the library faculty too. As soon as these librarians' training is complete, OER Leads supplies them with funding for OER adoption programs at their own campuses so that they can immediately put these skills into practice. In our first year, we had 7 participating OER Leads librarians. And throughout this first year together, we've worked with almost 40 courses. So that's fall 2022 and spring 2023 to make the switch to open, affordable, or library licensed course materials. This year's group of OER Leads librarians are starting up their training now, and then later in the spring, we're going to join them up with our first group of OER Leads and begin a real community of practice for Penn State librarians working with open education at their individual campuses. We're hopeful that this is not only going to provide all of us with a support network of peers, mentors, and collaborators as we all continue to support open in our own ways, but that we, as the librarians, will also be able to provide better connections for our non-library peers throughout the university. Penn State University libraries often pride ourselves on being true to our designation as one library geographically dispersed. in that our librarians often work closely with colleagues across the state as we do with the people on our own campuses. So because of this, we're hoping that OER Leads will be extremely well positioned to both support faculty at other librarians' campuses and to help our own faculty connect with their peers at other campuses on questions, ideas, projects, things related to open pedagogy, OER authorship, and other areas of open education. And finally, OER Leads is also providing a model that clearly values faculty work by providing stipends for faculty who are willing to explore and adopt OER rather than asking them to do this additional work without additional compensation. And we know this is definitely like a pain point with OER work. It's hard to find that funding. And so we're trying to take the ability as Penn State to say, we do have this funding, let's set this model and show that like this is important to do when we can do it. And beyond that, OER Leads also introduces opportunities for development in terms of peer-reviewed publications and presentations from both the librarians and the teaching faculty involved through shared publications about the program in general or individual works on their own experiences. So I'm also going to drop one link into the chat for some more information about OER Leads. There's going to be a lot of links in the chat throughout our presentation. So with that, we're going to move on to our second strategy, assessment and open sharing. We have a few more examples for this area than we had for the last one. So I'm going to ask Larry to keep us rolling on the next slide.
Yeah, thanks, Elizabeth. Yeah, we've really seen this peer-to-peer sharing strategy has been very important and very useful in disseminating these open source opportunities. And, you know, this can certainly help with introducing new faculty to OER resources or adjuncts. You know, at Penn State, we have Valley, we have quite a few adjuncts, and sharing among campuses and disciplines. David mentioned, you know, interdisciplinary sharing, which is very important. And, you know, this can really help to overcome the initial hurdle of a course redesign that some faculty encounter so that a faculty member is not starting from scratch in their investigation and adoption of OER material. We found sometimes it's overwhelming, you know, if a faculty member is interested in adopting OER material, there's so much content out there, it's hard to navigate the waters. And so, one strategy we've used is to compile and share OER implementation data on a discipline basis and even on a course by course basis. And we've seen really taking it down to that very specific level of a course by course basis is very helpful for faculty, new faculty, adjuncts to you know, make good progress in adopting OER materials. It's important to share OER successes to raise visibility. You know, it's good to share OER initiatives, adoptions, new OER investigations that might be going on. You can use campus newsletters or some other mechanisms to get the word out. And another option we sometimes use is adding in an OER, a standing OER-related agenda item to faculty meetings as a kind of a trigger to so faculty can update what they're doing in terms of OER initiatives. If you go to the next slide, Elizabeth. And in terms of motivating OER development, Elizabeth mentioned things like stipends. We've seen a significant expansion of OER materials due to things like stipends or even publicizing the impact of OER adoption from the student perspective due to OER adoption. The cost savings, I think, are kind of obvious, but there's improved learning outcomes we found, right? Students have access to course materials on day one. Affordability is not a barrier for students to get course materials. So we've actually seen improved student outcomes using OER materials. And also just sharing OER implementation data, publicizing OER accomplishments and successes, OER-based grants. If you go to the next slide, Elizabeth. And one other aspect, another initiative that I think has benefited open dissemination is and peer-to-peer sharing is periodic surveys that we do of faculty to compile the OER resources already in use by discipline and on a course level basis. And the Penn State Math Department, we've been doing this for about 4 years now. And this has really helped faculty get started with OER development and implementation, since again, revising a course to use OER materials is a very significant undertaking. And so this type of data collection, I think, can assist faculty to see what colleagues have done in terms of OER implementation, what they've tried, what has worked, what hasn't worked. So, avoiding the need to reinvent the wheel. This can be, I think, especially useful for adjuncts, to motivate adjuncts to incorporate OER. It can be especially important for multi-campus university, right? So that we can share among campuses. So OER development. And just to look at this example that's on the bottom of this slide. This is just a small excerpt from one of our reports. This is showing a course called, we call Math 110, which is a first course in the calculus sequence. So for example, this is four faculty members at four different campuses, Penn State campuses, that have taken slightly different approaches to open source materials for their courses. And not only is this referencing the textbooks used, but the ancillaries, such as online assessment tools, graphing tools, and things like that. And so, this type of dissemination, I think, can definitely help overcome that initial inertia that some faculty might have regarding a course redesign to, to adopt OER materials. So we have this kind of a reporting format across all of our math courses, and we've gotten very positive feedback from faculty that have said, I was thinking about OER investigation. I wasn't sure how to get started. I can get a good starting point in my effort. So we think this kind of a kind of a data collation is very useful. I think I'll pass it back to Elizabeth then.
Perfect, thank you. So we also have some other surveying projects that are focused around open more generally. The first is, again, that OER Leads project I mentioned before. A huge component of OER Leads is the requirement for participating faculty in the program to allow their OER Lead librarian to visit the class near the end of each semester and administer a voluntary student survey. The survey is built on one that we used in a previous OER adoption program at Penn State Abington called ACCFF. Unfortunately, we don't have enough time to go over that project in any detail, but the link on this slide and what I'm going to put in the chat as well will take you to a recently published article on ACCFF, which includes a link to that survey. And of course, we'd be happy to share the survey we're working with too. This student survey is currently being distributed to our participating courses students. And so far we have a pretty good response rate, but we're not done yet. We are pairing this eventually with a faculty survey so that we can look at experiences with and perceptions of OER from both perspectives. We're going to be analyzing that data this summer, and we hope to be sharing our findings and publishing as soon as possible. Another great example of open sharing at Penn State Lehigh Valley is the Open and Affordable Showcase event. We introduced this half-day conference in 2022 as a way to literally showcase and celebrate the work that members of our campus were doing around open. Anyone, faculty or staff, is invited to submit a proposal to give a lightning talk on their work with OPEN during the showcase. One important note, though, is that the showcase event was originally designed by our campus librarians as a way to host the OPEN Champion Award at our campus. This award is given across multiple Penn State campuses, so far always through the campus library, but each library has the freedom to decide how they're going to choose an award winner and the criteria by which the award is given. So we felt that when we wanted to implement this on our campus is already so fantastically collaborative that it would really be best to have the campus itself choose the winner each year. We didn't want to go by something arbitrary like savings numbers. We really wanted it to be kind of an all-around experience. So the Open and Affordable Showcases Lightning Talks give us that structure. Each presenter is invited to share their ongoing or past work with open education. And then the audience for the presentation grades each presenter on a rubric that considers how much of an impact they're having on their students' learning, on reducing financial barriers to that learning, as well as how innovative or creative their work with open education has been. I'm pleased to tell you that my co-presenter today, Larry Mussolino, was our first ever winner of the Open Champion Award for our campus last year. And we're all looking forward to meeting our new winner at this year's showcase in May. So this event has been a really good success for us in terms of sharing work with open education, which is awesome in itself. But the event was actually so well received that it turned out to be a fantastic professional development opportunity as well. We had great attendance from not just our faculty, but also our staff and administrators, which included our campus chancellor and our director of academic affairs, who had we'd invited them to give remarks throughout the day, but they actually both took time out of their schedules to attend longer and to participate in our roundtable discussions. We had put those into the programming as a way to have some like guided learning and thought sharing over lunch. But because our attendance was so great and so diverse, they actually became truly productive conversations that allowed our faculty, staff, and administrators to discuss what open means at our campus, both philosophically and practically. One additional note here, unlike OER Leads that has the stipends for adoptions, this is an event that we run on an extremely small budget. Our only expense is food. The Open Champion Award doesn't have a monetary award with it, and the university libraries absorbs the cost of the actual award plaque and the winner's plate, which you could get around by not having a physical component to the award. So our campus doesn't pay that. It does come with a very high cost in terms of time, though, because all of this is planned internally and hosted on the day by our two campus librarians, myself and my head librarian. But we are more than happy to share our planning materials and help somebody else get a running start with an event like this. And I'm actually going to put a link into the chat for the presentation that's linked on this slide, in which there is a link to a folder of planning materials. We gave the most, the broadest materials in that, but please, if you're interested in this, please feel free to reach out. And we'd be happy to look at what else we have and see if there's anything else that we can kind of tailor or help you with. So that brings us to the end of our presentation. Again, thank you all for listening. And we're really excited for the questions that have come in through the chat and for the Q&A session. And again, you should have the link to the slide and all those links in the chat to get to all these other presentations. But if you're missing anything or you want more information, please feel free to reach out to us. I'll put our emails in the chat as well.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth and Larry. I'm like overwhelmed at like the quantity of programming that you're doing. It's so impressive and inspiring, and I'm excited to dive back into the slideshow later and click on the links and learn more about your work. So thank you to the both of you, and again to David. Well, we've got about 11 minutes left, which is great. So I'm gonna scroll back up through the chat and bring some questions back around. David, I know one of the first questions was to you, which was, can you briefly like expand on what the mini grants funded and what products or goals, you know, might have the mini grants funded or the faculty associated with them?
Sure. So those mini grants, I think, probably related to the initial round of alt textbook grants, probably 10 years ago or so. They were $1,000 per successful applicant at that time. We still offer grants now, I should also mention, but larger, they're about $2,500. Typically, it tends to cover the same type of thing, essentially. It's very much sort of project specific, but I know that folks have used it for things like hiring like a graphic designer to help them create something on their website or in their text, for instance. I know most commonly, actually, people have used that grant to hire students to assist them with the process. It's gone on sort of labor costs. We've had applicants that have spent it on attending conferences to talk about their experience at the art textbook, in the art textbook program, for instance. So they can use it in all sorts of ways. Some faculty will, you know, because they are spending time working on these projects outside of their normal work hours, they are able to use it for additional compensation as well. So yeah, there's a lot of flexibility with how those grants get utilized. And I'll also mention very quickly, because I didn't mention it in my presentation, so slap on the wrist to me. For the first cohort in the incubator, we also provided some very small mini grants for them. And then at the end of that, because we had some initial funding to pilot the program, we asked them, how important was it to have that money? And everybody said, I would have done it regardless. And I didn't, you know, it wasn't large enough where it would have had a big enough impact to change anything. So we haven't offered grants since that in return for participation in the incubator. I wish we could, though, because I do believe in compensating people for their time, but we don't at the moment.
Thanks, David. Elizabeth, I think this one is for you, but maybe both you and Larry. There's a question about the ACCFF survey and if it's IRB approved.
Make sure I'm on, oh good, I am unmuted. It's IRB exempted. The questions we asked for ACCFF, we didn't ask about anything, like we didn't ask about grades, we didn't ask about anything that would have been so it went through the IRB process and it was exempted. The OER LEADS survey is built on the ACCFF survey. It was also exempted, but we do ask some more demographic stuff in that one than we did for the ACCFF survey. Because for ACCFF, it was just one campus. We already knew the demographics of the campus. For OER LEADS, it's across 8 different campuses. So we wanted to be able to just catch if there was anything else happening. But yeah, they both, so it depends. I don't know if it matters for your institution, but it was technically exempted rather than approved.
Great, thank you. Mm-hmm. This might be, David, this was directed toward you, but it's applicable to both presentations, which is, can you talk briefly about whether or not like OER work, open textbook implementation, if any of that counts toward tenure and promotion at your institutions, if you have any knowledge of that?
Yeah, I have a little. So I know from following up with folks who've been through the program that they have included it in their reappointment dossier. In some cases, I think specifically stating it was valuable for networking across campus and for leadership in general. That's not the phrase I'm sure they used, but sort of that ilk. So it has been included in P&T dossiers, yeah, which is great, and also feels nice for us as well that we were able to provide that for them.
Elizabeth or Larry, do you want to speak to that at your institution?
Well, I'll just add a similar comment that David made, in that at Penn State, it is viewed as a very valuable addition to a dossier, and you know, it's sometimes looked at in the perspective of improving pedagogy, improving student learning outcomes. Because again, I think we all know about the cost savings, but I think sometimes we miss the extra benefits of, helping students be more successful with open source materials. And again, there's been studies done that compare courses with, you know, traditional materials versus open source materials, and there's been statistically significant improved learning outcomes for courses using OER materials. So I think that's an important part of, you know, faculty's overall goals and objectives.
So I was listening a little too closely to David and Larry's responses, and I've now forgotten what the question was. Could you repeat it, Ryan?
Sure. It was just about you know, if and how OER work, counts toward tenure and promotion at your institution.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. I know. I think there's been some discussions with Faculty Senate about like, how is this valued? How should it be valued? So there's definitely work ongoing with that. I mean, of course, that's a process and a half getting tenure changed. But I do know, like from the librarian faculty perspective, I'm next year getting my sixth year dossier ready, and a good portion of my dossier is all about OER. So there are some nice models from like the library faculty world on how OER fits into this stuff, how you value it, how it shows up in things. So I'm hopeful that it'll get a little bit more mainstreamed with the rest of this too, because it is, if nothing else, like, you know, it's like Larry was saying, huge for learning outcomes, it's huge for cost savings, but it's also a nice recruitment point for the university, to be able to say, like, this is, you know, we can give you a degree where you're not paying for course materials. We can do these zero cost degrees, zero cost programs and stuff. So it is a benefit to the university as well to have this going on.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more. David, there was a question about the workshops that are part of the program. And I think you touched on this briefly, but I know they have to do four, but are they choosing from like a larger menu of workshops? And what are the topics for the workshops and how are those determined?
Yes, yeah, thank you, Ryan. Yeah, so that's right. We ask at least four, and then we have this a menu or a buffet, I guess, of workshops that are available. They are sort of either topic or sort of theory based. So in terms of, when I say topic, I mean tool. In terms of our tool-based ones, we've done things around social annotation. So sort of hands-on work with Hypothesis and VoiceThread, that sort of thing. Wiki.edu, we've done things around sort of critical making. So we've brought in our Makerspace librarian to lead a workshop on that. We've done stuff around Twitch. In terms of the theory stuff, universal accessibility, so universal design for learning and OER is one that we strongly recommend our participants do. Public access, engagement, copyright obviously is one, publishing, and those are just a few. Those are off the sort of the top of my head. The actual menu itself is probably 12 to 16 different workshops. And we have those four, we have the longer ones, but then we also in the second half of the program revert to the more sort of TED Talky stuff as well. So they're technically still workshops, but they're not quite the same depth. They're more sort of scratching the surface there.
That's great. Thank you. Well, thank you again, David, Elizabeth, Larry, for these presentations. Again, like not only informative, but very, very inspiring. I just have a few quick announcements before we go on our way for the day. Just an advertisement for our upcoming webinars. We have additional webinars on March 8th, 12th, and 10th. So look out for those in your inboxes. A little advertisement, Una put this in the chat, but as many of you know, March 6th through the 10th is Open Education Week. So there's a week of fantastic programming. So please check out the Open Education Week website, as well as the listserv. We'll be very active with opportunities for that week. And lastly, please stay in the loop. We have upcoming conferences. You can join our community email, which is very active, and read our EDI blog posts and student OER impact stories at CCC OER. Liz put this link in the chat, but our surveys, our post-webinar surveys are super helpful. They help us figure out future programming and reflect on how we did today. So if you have time, please complete that survey for us. And I think that's it. There's our contact information if you want to get in touch with us. Like I said, we do these monthly, so we have three more for the spring 23 semester. We hope to see many of you there. And if you have ideas about future topics, feel free to contact me or anyone on the Professional Development Committee. Thanks again for being here. Best of luck with the rest of your semesters. And my thanks once again to our presenters. Take care, everyone.